welcome to a special edition of Medicine Meadville. I'm Dwayne Kohler from Meadville Medical Center, and we are kicking off our community conversation Ask the Expert series today with a talk about Parkinson's disease. So we have Wendy Blaschik from speech therapy, and she's going to go second. Kicking off will be Janelle Therese from physical therapy. And their topic is called LSVT Big, LSVT Loud. So they're going to explain what that means, but this is all about Parkinson's disease. So it's a very, very interesting topic. So stay tuned.
My name is Janelle. Here today to talk about Parkinson's disease and specifically the LSVT loud and LSVT big treatment approach for Parkinson's. Back in October, I went to a course that was a weekend long to get certified in the LSVT big treatment. I had had patients before this with Parkinson's disease, and I felt like I was able to treat them pretty well, but they never really made progress. They just maintained the level that they were at, which is good for that disease, but I wanted to be able to help them more. While I was a student, I saw other therapists that were certified in this training. So when I became a therapist, that was one of the things that I really wanted to be able to do. So the LSVT stands for Lee Silverman Voice Training. This treatment approach was originally designed for speech and to help people with Parkinson's be able to speak louder. It's named Lee Silverman because the lady that first went through the treatment was named Lee Silverman, and her family members said, we wish we could just understand what she was saying. She was in the late stages, having a really hard time projecting her voice. And they said, if you could just help us be able to hear her, that would be great. So LSVT Loud was developed. She went through the treatment, and it helped her to be able to communicate with her family members. As you can see, the LSVT Loud is an intensive amplitude-based program for speech. Wendy's actually going to talk about this more the next half hour. My side is the LSVT Big. It can be provided by a certified occupational therapist, physical therapist, or occupational therapy assistant, or physical therapy assistant. It is also amplitude-based at a high intensity with the goal of improving functional mobility. So a little background on what Parkinson's disease is first, before I talk about the treatment. As you can see the definition, it's a progressive neurological disorder characterized by a number of motor and non-motor features that can impact function to a variable degree. Parkinson's disease isn't one of those diseases where you can draw blood and have a test that says, oh, they have Parkinson's disease. It's diagnosed by criteria, and the four cardinal features are having a tremor at rest, rigidity, which is being very stiff and not having fluid movements, akinesia or bradykinesia. Akinesia is uncoordinated movements, and bradykinesia is very slow movements, and the postural instability. Here's a list of both the motor and the non-motor symptoms. Not everybody will have all of these symptoms. It's kind of like a buffet. Some people will have some people will have the other. Some people might have all of them. On the left-hand side, the motor, things like tremor, the slowness, the rigidity, the postural instability, those were the cardinal features of Parkinson's. They also demonstrate a decreased arm swing as they walk. Their gait becomes shuffling. They have difficulty arising from a chair or turning or even getting into bed. The micrographia is small handwriting. They'll notice, sometimes that's one of the first symptoms that you notice, is that their handwriting has gotten so small you can barely read it. The last few things down there have to do with blinking. The glabellar reflex, I found interesting, has to do with tapping on your forehead right here. And the first time or two when you tap on someone's forehead, they'll blink. But then they'll realize you're not hitting them in their eye and they won't blink anymore. Someone with Parkinson's continues to blink, no matter how many times you do that. The striatal deformity happens in the hands and the feet. One of the things with Parkinson's is they have the flex posture. Then these hands kind of get stuck like this, and their toes and feet also go into a flex position and then kind of get stuck. Scoliosis and the camptoremia are just fancy words for the posture being forward slumped and off to one side. The non-motor, big list over there. Unfortunately, the treatment does not directly affect the non-motor symptoms of this disease, but everything in red are things that you can see improvement with after going through this treatment. I highlighted the depression and fatigue. I'm not a counselor, I don't help them not be depressed, but just the ability to move better and perform their daily activities better, they feel better about themselves, they have more energy, and they have less depression. This is a picture of the typical appearance of a Parkinson's patient. So you'll notice the stoop posture. One thing that a lot of people miss is that they have a masked facial expression. So they might think that your joke's funny, but they just look like they're wearing a mask. They don't show that emotion on their face, which was hard to get past at first because I think I'm funny and I think they should be laughing. But you have to understand that even though they feel that way, their face isn't going to show it like yours and mine would. The rigidity happens mostly in the trunk. You'll notice it a lot with turning. They won't be able to turn. They'll have to turn their whole body. The reduced arm swing is pretty much a dead giveaway when they're walking. One or both arms will just hang right down towards their side. Their elbows and their wrists become flexed. Their knees and their hips become flexed so that they get down in that crouch posture, and then they take the little tiny steps. So what causes Parkinson's? 85% of Parkinson's is idiopathic, which is a fancy word for there is no reason, it just occurs. Of the idiopathic Parkinson's, there's three types. There's tremor dominant, postural instability, and gait dominant. And those are just based on what symptom affects them the most. On the left, you can see secondary Parkinson's. Secondary Parkinson's occurs as a result of a different injury. So someone could have a stroke that affects the basal ganglia, which then gives Parkinson's-like symptoms. A brain tumor, trauma, anything like that, if it affects the basal ganglia, you'll have Parkinson's-like symptoms. But it's not true Parkinson's, because true Parkinson's is idiopathic. You also have atypical Parkinson's. Again, you'll get all those same symptoms. They'll look like they have Parkinson's, but it's due to one of those other diseases or processes in the brain. This treatment has been tested and designed for people with idiopathic Parkinson's, although they taught us in the course that if it's not idiopathic, try it anyways, because they still will get the benefit. They just can't say that it's proven effective for the other types. So how does this treatment work? Basically, we use the principles of neuroplasticity, which is a big fancy word for making changes in the brain. We use a simple focus of amplitude of big movements, intensive, high effort, high energy practice. So we use the 0 to 10 pain scale a lot, 0 being none at all, 10 being the worst you can imagine. Every session, I want them to be at 7 out of 10 effort, which is kind of different than most neurological diseases. You feel like you don't want to push them too far or fatigue them too much. But to make the best changes in the brain, they need to be working at that 7 out of 10 effort. We also do lots and lots of repetition so that they overlearn the movements. So in the treatment, as long as they're coming to therapy and doing their homework every day, they get 236 repetitions of big movement a day, which is 3,776 repetitions of big movement every month. In addition to all the practice, in the treatment session, I want to make it complex so that they stay interested in it. And I also want to make it salient, which means that it's meaningful to them. Because if it isn't meaningful to them, they won't do it. The way I do that is each day they have a carryover task. So when they leave therapy, I give them one thing to do that night at home. So that every time they go to do that, they think, oh, this is my carryover task. I need to do this big. So that can be things such as getting up out of the chair. Every time you go to get a glass of water or go to the bathroom, I want you to use those big steps. Also, the hierarchy tasks promote continuous use of this idea. So the hierarchy tasks are a combination of standing up, walking, opening doors, so that it's more like real life. And then they're able to integrate that into their life. I also use feedback and motivation, which has been probably the most difficult part for me because I really like to correct what they're doing rather than give them good feedback. But just like training anything, you want them to know when they're doing it right. So before treatment, someone with Parkinson's will have problems with their perception and self-awareness. So even though all of us are able to see that they're moving very slowly, taking small steps, and having all of those symptoms that I described earlier, they don't realize it. So pre-treatment, they don't realize that they're doing the small steps, so that triggers more small movements, reduce motor output, so when they're moving small, they're not able to do the big movements. And self-cueing, it continues to tell the muscles, move smaller, move slower. And they just get into this cycle of smaller, slower, and never get to move bigger. So the treatment focus is to produce larger movements with increased amplitude of muscle output. I want them to improve their self-cueing because I'm not always going to be there to be yelling, big, do that bigger. Did that feel big enough? And I also want them to be aware of their movements. If they don't know that they're moving slow, that they're slow or small, they're never going to be able to do it larger or bigger. So the very first day, like any physical therapy, I do an evaluation. It starts with an interview of lots and lots of questions, just so I get an idea of what their daily life looks like, what's meaningful to them, so that I can shape the treatment to them. I do standardized testing of the 5-time sit-to-stand test. They're in a chair, not using their arms. They stand up and sit back down 5 times, and I time how long it takes them. The timed up-and-go test, they're sitting in a chair, and there's a cone 10 meters away. They walk down and around and back and sit in the chair, and I time how long that takes. 6-minute walk test, I put 6 minutes on the clock, and we go for a walk. I measure how far they can go in that 6 minutes. And the mini best test is a test for balance and stability, and it has a bunch of different challenges on it so that I get an idea of how their balance is. Also on the first day, I do a stimulatability task. I need to make sure that they can move big and that it's not an orthopedic issue or something that is limiting them, that it's definitely just the Parkinson's that's making them take these small steps. So as long as they're able to model big walking and swinging their arms, they're a good candidate for this treatment. So the treatment approach with the high intensity, it's 4 days a week for 4 weeks. Each session is 60 minutes. And then every day you have daily homework and the carryover tasks. Each session we start with the maximal daily exercises. We move on to 5 functional tasks. I also use shaping rather than telling them you need to lift that arm up higher or put that arm at a 90-degree angle. I walk over and put their arm there. I don't want them thinking about exactly where they need their arm. I want them to feel how it feels to be in that position. So after I put them in the right position, I say, "Do you see how that feels? Now the next time, do it just like that." That also helps the limited cognitive load. Like I said, the only thing I want them thinking about is moving big. So for the maximal daily exercises, these are some of the things that I would say: big arm swing, finish big, big open hands, big effort, big posture. So at this point, if you guys want to space out just a little bit, and then we'll try a couple of exercises. So the first exercise of the maximal daily exercises, we always start with our big posture. So you're up away from the back of your chair and nice and tall. The first one, you're going to reach out big, down big, up big, and then out. So here we hold this one for a count of 10. Everyone says, why don't you make them count? So if I made them count, that would add the cognitive load. So until the third or fourth week, I count for them. I just want them to focus on how this feels being big. After this, they finish big. Okay, let's do one more like that. So now that you know what they are, I want big effort, big crisp movements. Out, down, up, and out. So towards the third or fourth week, when this starts to get easy, we add in what we call flicks. You can do hand flicks, or you can do whole arm flicks. So you're doing big movements with the arm, and then you still finish big. Those flicks are pretty interesting. That was something I had never used in therapy before. But for people that have trouble buttoning or really small motions, especially with the Parkinson's, so if you go to button, you're moving real slow, I have them stop, do five big flicks, and then go in for that button big. I was surprised how much better it worked when they were able to get the bigger hand motions. So there's two exercises in the chair, but the rest of them are all standing. So we'll try one of the standing ones. So all of these exercises, like that first one, I like to relate to function. So when you're reaching forward big and out big, it really simulates standing up from a chair. You have to have that forward weight shift to be able to stand up. This next exercise simulates things such as going up steps, walking, stepping over an obstacle that's in your path, or even stepping into the bathtub. So this one starts big, tall posture again. You're going to take a big step forward and throw those arms out to your side. Good. Then this one ends in the same spot with a big finish. Doesn't seem too difficult, and they're really not. All I want you to do is just swing the arms with a big step and then finish big. We repeat those on both sides. We also do ones out to the side, and we do backwards as well. Just helps with all the different ways you might move and gait. I really enjoy the backwards one because people are like, oh, I never do that motion. But if you're opening the fridge, you have to step back to get out of the way of the door. And people that have trouble with their balance backwards, that backwards step, and now they're going backwards. So if they're able to step and regain their balance through this exercise, they're more likely to be able to do it at home when they're in that situation. Okay, I'll let you guys sit back down. Some considerations while doing the exercises. Bigness and quality are the main focus. So I don't want the exercises to get so big that they're unsafe. The forward step isn't supposed to be a lunge. It's supposed to be just a large forward step. Like I said, I try to link them to functional tasks as much as possible so that they're meaningful to the patient. Family support is very helpful. I link this to like having a workout buddy. If you have these exercises, yeah, I should do those. But until someone's there motivating you to do them with you, you'll be more likely to do them if someone's there to help you to do them. There's also adaptations of all of these exercises. If someone's very advanced in their Parkinson's disease, all of these can be done seated. They can also be done laying down, or they can be done with upper extremity supports such as a chair or parallel bars to hold on to. I like to progress the exercises to challenge the patient so that they remain interested. Those flicks are one way that we progress it. Adding the cognitive load of having them count progresses it. If they get really good, I put the wrist weights on them so that for all these, they're holding a pound or two out there. Or I add a dual task. So one of the ones that I've done is give them squeezy balls so that they have to squeeze the whole time that they're doing it. Or having them count backwards by fives from 100, anything I can do to challenge them so that when they're out in the real world and someone's talking to them or asking them questions, they're still able to do everything big. So the very last visit, after the 16 visits, I perform all those standardized tests again so I can see what kind of improvement they've made. I do an exit interview and ask them if they're moving more now that they've completed the treatment, if they've seen any improvement at home, if anyone at their home or out in the community has noticed that they're moving bigger. And I don't give them these questions ahead of time, but I've been surprised at how they're answering it just textbook-wise. I also schedule follow-up appointments. We kind of use the dentist model. So after their 16 visits are up, a month later, I see them back in just to make sure that they're still doing their exercises, still doing well. If they're still moving well, I schedule them out 6 more months just to check up, make sure they're not having any problems, make sure that they're still doing well. The homework does not end after the 16 visits. So we do all this work during treatment to help recalibrate their system to move bigger. The maximal daily exercises are now part of their daily routine. They do that from here on out. And that really helps to maintain that big movement. If they stop doing that, then they'll slip back into the small movements. So it's very important to keep up on their exercises. So, does it work? During the course, they showed us a lot of different videos, and I wasn't really a believer, like, oh yeah, it works when you do it, but does it work when I do it? So these are my first 3 patients. The timed up and go test, the minimal detectable change is 4 seconds. Not all of them had a 4-second improvement, but they all improved their time. The 5-time sit to stand, I wrote the 16 seconds under there because the 16 seconds is what has been determined for individuals with Parkinson's. If they can perform the 5-time sit to stand in less than 16 seconds, they're at a decreased risk for falls. So patient number 1, his first day, 20 seconds. Our last day, 13 seconds. So according to that data, I decreased his fall risk. Patient number 2, he was pretty good to begin with, and he still improved. I watched him do the 5-time sit to stand and thought, there's no way he's gonna do any better than that. He flew out of that chair, but he still improved. Patient number 3, he's pretty far progressed in his Parkinson's. The very first time we did the 5-time sit to stand, the typical test, your arms are crossed here. He needed his arms to help push up out of the chair to begin with. Post-test, we didn't need his arms anymore. So to be able to do it in the same time without pushing up, I thought was pretty good. 6-minute walk test, patient number 1 really liked walking. He really got going after our therapy sessions and incorporated the walking part into his daily life. Nearly, almost doubled his walking distance in the 6 minutes. Patient number 2, he was pretty speedy. The girls down the hall said, I think he's running you for a walk. To go 1,500 feet in 6 minutes is at a pretty quick pace. Patient number 3, he had a difficult time with the walking, so we didn't improve as much as I would like to, but the 700 feet for him was quite a bit to begin with. So I have some videos that my patients have signed off and given me releases to be able to show these to you. So this is my first one. On the left is before treatment. On the right is his last day of treatment. So you'll notice things that we worked on, the arm swing, the step length, the posture. So this one is interesting. This is on the right is after treatment. On the left is a month later. So on the left, I haven't seen him for a whole month, but he's been doing his exercises at home. think most notably his arm swing has remained. He's not just holding his arms there anymore, and his step length is still really good. This gentleman is patient number 3 with the further progressed Parkinson's. He was having a lot of falls at home and still had a lot of falls even during treatment. I'm most amazed by this one. The video side by side is the timed up and go test. I say go at the same time in both videos. Watch him turn to get to his chair there. And now watch his turn to the chair here. He nearly cut his time in half with his walking and whatnot. He had the most difficulty getting up out of the chair. He was the one that needed his arms to begin with. And after the treatment, you can see he's able to get up. No problem. Interestingly, he had some circumstances that he ended up canceling a couple times, so we only really got 10 treatment sessions in with him. I really would like to see what would happen if I was able to get the full 16.
Hi, my name's Ann White. I'd like to share with you your health tip for the day. We are offering a new lecture series for our community to promote lifelong learning. These lecture series are going to be held at the Mind Body Wellness Center starting at 5:15. The doors are opening, and the lecture starting at 5:30 to 6:30. We're calling this informal lecture series Community Conversations. Topics will range from things like good nutrition to maintaining a healthy heart, injury prevention in youth sports, specifically looking at concussions, and even interesting things about our community. As part of this lifelong learning series, we're promoting community education and awareness. So please take the time to look and see what's being offered at the Mind Body Wellness Center, again the second Tuesday of the month. And that is your health tip for the day.
Hi, I'm Wendy. Good evening. I'm one of the speech therapists that does outpatient therapy up at Vernon Place. And I'm going to talk to you about the LSVT loud component of this program. So a little bit of statistics. Parkinson's disease affects 8 million people worldwide and 1.5 million in the USA. And 89% have speech and voice problems, and only 4% receive traditional speech therapy. I thought that was interesting, that that's not something that more people with Parkinson's actually seek out. So these are some of the initial speech characteristics in Parkinson's disease. Sometimes people will have is reduced loudness. They might have a hoarse vocal quality. Their articulation or the way they say their sounds may be a little bit slushy or slurred or imprecise. And sometimes they'll have like a vocal tremor. Oftentimes people report the decreased volume, the hoarse voice, or a monotone voice as their first symptoms of their Parkinson's disease. So what is LSVT loud? LSVT loud, or the Lee Silverman voice treatment, is a voice treatment for adults and children with neurological disorders with a specialty in Parkinson's disease. So when I did the online course, they actually talked about using this not only for Parkinson's patients, but for patients even like with MS, that were having issues with volume, and even children that had issues with volume because of maybe some apraxia or something. So I thought that was quite interesting. So frequently, when someone has Parkinson's disease, their perception of their voice is that they talk loud. But in reality, this is just a little to show, in reality, even though they feel like they're talking loud, they're actually very soft. And so using the intense effort and practice, the goal of LSVT Loud is to actually recalibrate or improve the patient's perception of their voice. So LSVT focuses only on one aspect of voice, and that's vocal loudness. And we do that through using reminders from the speech therapist, along with family members, as well as using things like a decibel monitor to help them work on self-monitoring their vocal loudness. So the target is vocal loudness. That's the only thing we work on. We don't work on over-exaggerating speech or anything else. We just are working on the one aspect, which is vocal loudness. So why is that? The reason being is that when someone talks loud, the vocal loudness enhances the effort and coordination across all of speech. So with increased loudness, increased intelligibility or their ability to be understood actually just follows and falls right into place. It's interesting because, and I have someone going through the program now, and it's quite interesting because just with the vocal loudness, just with having him do things like take a deep breath and say it a little louder, his speech automatically slows down. But the only thing he has to remember is that he has to talk loud. So loudness is what you feel, but what actually happens is a normal voice. So sometimes, I know in the first couple sessions with the person I have now, he would often say, I feel like I'm shouting. But when I monitor him with the decibel monitor, his voice is actually within normal limits for what voice, conversational voice should be. So the reason it feels louder is because his body has to work harder to produce that loud voice. So this is what loud triggers, and we're going to do a little bit of an activity with this as well. So when you ask someone to talk loud, automatically you sit up straighter, you take a deep breath, you open your mouth, your articulation improves, and your rate of speech decreases. So just being that one aspect, which again places a really low cognitive load on the patient so they don't have to remember a lot of things, it helps just all of those things follow in line. So this is our patient, so talking soft and so being loud, so our posture is improved and our perception is improved. So I want you to take a minute. I want to practice loud. Okay, so during my session, the first thing we would do would we would practice 15 loud ahs. When I do the initial evaluation, one of the things that is standardized to measure is someone's maximum phonation time. The normal time for maximum phonation or the ability to say an ah is 15 seconds. So all of us in this room probably should be able to do about 15 seconds of that ah. Some people might be a little longer, some people might be a little shorter, but normal is 15 seconds. So what I want you to do is sit up nice and straight. I want you to take a deep breath, open your mouth as wide as you can, and I want you to say in your loudest voice, say hello.
Hello.
Okay, great. So how did that feel? So did you notice that when you did take the deep breath and you opened your mouth that immediately your posture was better and your breath support was for speech was just a little bit better at that point? Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about how someone, if someone was interested in getting LSVT loud, what they would have to do. So first of all, the doctor has to write an order, and they would refer someone for a speech therapy evaluation. And we would look at aspects of voice and speech along with cognition and swallowing. So these are some of the things that we would do at the initial evaluation. So during the initial evaluation, we'd interview the patient and look at their medical history and their neurological history. We'd gather like if they've had any surgical history, and we look at how they're moving around their mouth muscles, like if they can stick out their tongue, if they move their tongue around, if they can open their mouth. We look at voice information. If we think that it's all related to Parkinson's, or if we're concerned that there might be anything else wrong, we may ask for an ENT consult or an ear, nose, and throat doctor to look at their vocal cords to make sure they're moving okay. We want to make sure that there's nothing going on like with their vocal cords, that there might be something that the ENT should be able to see. We also look at swallowing. Sometimes people with Parkinson's will have swallowing issues, and sometimes swallowing issues, especially if they have like reflux, it can cause your voice to be a little bit more rough and gravelly. So we would look at swallowing. And we'd look at also cognition and their language information to see if they're able to follow directions and their stimulability to do the program. At Vernon Place, we're lucky we have the Visi pitch, which is an instrumental method of assessing the voice. So it does a lot of measurements for us. It looks at, on that Visi pitch, we look at things like the duration of their ability to say ah. So can someone say ah for how their length of their maximum phonation time? Is it like 3 seconds, 12 seconds? My current patient, when I did his initial evaluation, his duration of ah was 6 seconds, which was a little low. His last session with me, his duration of ah was 12 seconds. So just in the last few weeks, he has doubled his length of phonation time. We also look at their loudness, like how loud, what their volume is for their speech. We look at their fundamental frequency, like their highest pitch, if they can go from a highest pitch to a low pitch. And then we also look at things like reading and their loudness during reading and talking tasks. So generally, the dosage of LSVT loud is 16 sessions. The length is 1 hour, and the duration is 4 weeks. Now, the patient I currently have, we've modified it a little bit with him because he could not come from where he was living 4 times a week. So we did modify it, and he's just finishing up now. The goal is then to recheck within a month, and then three to six months, and a year later, to see if they're maintaining their abilities. So during the session of the LSVT loud, what we normally start with is we do a lot of measurements. I use like a sound level meter that I've actually downloaded to my iPad here at work, and it was free, it was an application, but you can actually, someone could download them at home. There's also an LSVT companion that can be downloaded with the therapist, and then also a patient going through the program can download that too. So you can actually use it as a monitor when you're doing your home practice. The reason you use the decibel monitor is it helps to give you feedback during your session. So when it's sitting there, the goal on the decibel monitor, and I'm going to see if I can bring this up and I'll pass it around. So, there's another one that I don't know. I had it on my phone for a while, and for some reason it froze, and it was showing like it actually had a better visual feedback to it. But the decibel, the monitor will move, and it also, like at the bottom, you can actually see if you keep a steady, like a long ah, should, like if you do it really long, you could actually see like your voice go straight across the screen on the bottom. If you have like a tremor to your voice, then it's actually going to go up and down. We also use a stopwatch basically to time those ahs, because I want to know if their ahs are effortful, they're loud, and they're and the length of time they are. During this session, I also have a big sign that I put up, and I send that sign home with the patient to put it someplace where they're going to be talking at home, that says, think loud. Again, the program focuses on using a lot of visual and feedback so that the patient can start carrying over those strategies. Think loud. So these are just some times that we communicate. So when you think about communication, we communicate on the phone, the grocery store, the restaurant, with friends, pets, neighbors, spouse, volunteer, children, and hobbies. So during this session, the things we work on, the first one is sustaining awe 15 times in a good quality voice while using the decibel monitor. So that's the, and we want it to feel effortful, like you've actually worked out those muscles in your throat. And we want it to be loud and to meet the criteria of what a good conversational level speech should be. So if I start sustaining ah and I say ah, I'm going to say it that 15 times in a loud voice. If someone does that, then the next step of the program would be 15 ahs in a loud, good quality voice going from their normal pitch to their highest pitch. So if you would do ah, going from your normal pitch to your highest pitch. Again, that's working on improving the strength of the muscles in your throat. The next one I have trouble with, it's 15 repetitions of ah, going from your normal pitch to your lowest pitch. Ah, I am definitely a soprano. I just want you to know. So then the other thing we do is at the first session, we identify 10 phrases and sentences that are used in daily life that are very meaningful for the patient that's going through the program. So my 10 phrases could be totally different from your 10 phrases. And those phrases are going to be phrases that you're going to practice when you have to do the repetition of phrases, and it's 200 repetitions of phrases doing the loud program. It's those 10 phrases. So it could be something like, I love you. Did you take the dog out? Did you get coffee at the store? Did the Steelers win on Sunday? It could be anything like that, but it's sentences that are meaningful to you. And then the next part is there are sentences like that I have that are lists of 20 phrases and sentences that are read 10 times each for 200 repetitions. And that can be the sentences that you've picked or the sentences that we've decided to use in the book. And those can change from week to week. It could be something to make it so it's like this week it could be a shorter phrase, maybe you're getting better and the phrase can be longer. And then we also work on conversational discourse with the speech therapist, and then planning carryover activities. So like maybe calling your wife on the phone during the speech therapy session to remind her that she needs to stop at the bank and take out some money, or maybe practicing how you might ask the receptionist in the waiting room to schedule your next appointment. So things that we can carry over into everyday life. Because if you don't carry it out of my room, then it's not going to, your speech is going to stay the way it is. So during the session, the things that I do is model. So like, let's say you've started out and you've started with that ah, and your ahs have been really good, but we get to the conversational speech and then on your decibel monitor, your volume falls to like 50. I might say, okay, let's talk louder. Let's say that again. Say it like this, and then I would model it for you. So as Janelle had said, there's assignments for treatment and non-treatment days are provided to assist with carryover of the loud, good quality voice. It's really important that a family or friend can be trained to assist you with providing some feedback, as models and cues are helpful with someone with Parkinson's disease. On treatment days, daily tasks and exercises should be done one more time for about 10 minutes, and on non-treatment days, two times a day for 15 minutes. So when you leave, so if you come Monday through Thursday, then on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, you're going to practice your program that we've decided for 30 minutes that day. Sound level meters and the LSVT Loud Companion are available to download and to assist people at home. And so I just showed you the decibel meter, if you have a smartphone or the iPads, you can download a decibel meter to that. So in summary, LSVT Loud, or the Lee Silverman Voice Program, is a voice treatment for adults and children with neurological diseases and Parkinson's. Its basic target is vocal loudness. And with vocal loudness, improved breath support, posture, speech intelligibility, and reduced rate of speech follows. LSVT Loud is an intense program that encourages high effort within the treatment sessions. So I'm just going to leave you with the one thought, and that's to think loud and maybe think big.
Well, thanks, Janelle and Wendy, for presenting about Parkinson's disease today. If you did need some help with that area, call physical therapy or speech therapy at Meadville Medical Center. Just if you call 333-5000, they could get you hooked up with them. Also, thanks, Ann White, for the health tip today and talking about the Ask the Expert series. And we have a little flyer here. Coming up, we've got some things like medication safety, the Zika virus, mindful eating, sports nutrition, and many more things like that throughout the year. And we're adding a second piece of that this year, the how-to series. So there are going to be things, topics like how to brew beer, how to make a better picture, how to make better video. Dwayne's going to be the host of one on making lumber with your chainsaw. So that one's going to be a good one. You're going to have to watch that one. That one's in June. But so the Community Conversations Ask the Expert series, that's going to be going on all year long. So stay tuned for that. Okay, thanks for joining us today on Medicine in Meadville, and we'll talk to you next time.